Hello?
Hello, you're on the air. Go ahead.
Yes, Mr. Lewis. How you doing? I was just going to kind of call and poke fun at you about being on the air and some of those protesters coming down your street and start destroying your studio and everything.
They already are, Damon. They are right now.
They are. Yep. Yeah, and don't call for an armored car now.
No, I don't want one. I don't want one. I don't want a damn armored car. I don't want a shootout down below my studio. I don't want any of that. I want a peaceful protest. If they're going to protest, I want them to protest.
And how can the other guy, is the other gentleman from Occupy still there?
Yeah, he's still here.
Yeah, I'm here.
Yeah, I see. See, the problem with theories like that from Occupy is that you got 35 cops, you got 150 buildings and 3,000 cars, and you see one car that somebody vandalizes, and it's the cop's fault and not the thug. See, that's the problem.
Nobody said it was the cop's fault. They just said the cops allow for give the protesters a chance to make their move. If they decide to destroy something, then, of course, the cops have justification to move in and arrest them. That's how it is.
That's my point.
It's the game. It's cat and mouse. Let's see if the mouse will take the cheese. If the mouse takes the cheese, we're the cats, and we're going to attack them.
There's cheese everywhere. So, you know, he's assuming that's a throwdown car. You know, that's just the way Occupy people talk, you know, or think.
It's a throwdown. There's no doubt it's a throwdown. It's a contest.
And let me ask you this.
Don't act like this is all innocence, Damon. This is a contest to see who's going to prevail.
Yes.
And we all know who's going to prevail. We know who's going to prevail.
You keep saying police state. What exactly is your definition of police state? What does that mean?
When threats of coercion or violence is the preferred method of the state, that's a police state, my friend.
That's exactly right. Thank you so much for saying that. Damon, we'll be back with more. Don't go away. Keep it here.
Spinning complacently in the darkness, covered and blinded by a blanket of little lives, false security has lulled the madness of this world into a slumber. Wake up. An eye is upon you, staring straight down and keenly through, seeing all that you are and everything that you can never be. Yes, an eye is upon you, an eye ready to blink. So face forward, with arms wide open and mind reeling. Your future has arrived. Are you ready to go?
The loudspeaker spoke up and said,
"Wait, Jimmy."
The loudspeaker spoke up and said,
"Wait."
The loudspeaker spoke up and said, "Give up!
Give up!
Give up!
I'm Clyde Lewis, and this is Ground Zero. The numbers to call tonight, 888-673-3700. That's 888-673-3700. Tonight, of course, what else would we be talking about but what's happening right now? The chaos following the Ferguson announcement. The Ferguson officer was not charged in Michael Brown's death. Darren Wilson will not face charges of murder, manslaughter, or anything else, that he was justified. Although they are talking about civil charges, which, of course, are something that we knew would happen, that we thought would happen. What's really sad about this whole affair is that it never ceases to amaze me how, and I've said this before, you know, we're all revolutionaries when we're talking. But when there's a revolution to be had, when a revolution seems to be starting, we all turn on the revolutionaries. And that's something that Mao Zedong said would happen. That's something that's always happened. A lot of people want to continue their politics as usual without setting them aside. so they can be at least objective, so they can understand that the rules of the game are changing at a rapid rate and that Barack Obama has chosen to play within the boundaries of the global agenda. This is a global thing to see protests like this. This happens in England. This happens in Greece. This happens with Arab Spring. Now it's happening in Ferguson, Missouri. It's an agenda that has been put into play by despots that have rendered your ability to have life, liberty, the pursuit of happiness useless. Despotism and the police state that comes with despotism is so alien to the American mind that we foolishly believe that we've banned it or outgrown it like smallpox and Ebola. Well, Ebola came back. Smallpox comes back. I know we don't have, I know we've gotten rid of some things, but we haven't gotten rid of the possibility that a government or a despot could come in. I mean, I know it's contrary to national mythology that the United States never will wind up this way. We're always told that we're the land of the free, the home of the brave. We need to see that despotism is everywhere in human relations. If not uniform, it can appear in the workplace, in relationships, and in family situations. We're so used to it that when it appears in our government, we tend to accept it as a necessary evil. In fact, Mike Smith, who is with me tonight, former videographer of Ground Zero and has been in Ferguson, he had an interesting thing. He said that college is kind of like this. What were you saying about the college? You're taught so many things, and then...
Well, sure.
Go ahead,
I'll go back over that. It's something we discussed on the break. Well, I'm interested in brainwashing and how people are conditioned. And through grammar school, we're taught to study for the test, study, take the test. Okay, get your gold star, and then you're done. Mm-hmm. And then when we go to college, it's binge and purge again. It's study, get the test, I got to keep my grade point average so I can keep my loans, study, take the test, okay, now I'm done. Well, that kind of pattern solidified into your brain is being mimicked by the mainstream media. When there's a major event, there's a spree shooting, when there's a, another Ferguson, when there's, a major disaster, it's oversaturation of that story. Everybody's talking about it, from the talk show to the news broadcaster to the guy reading the news in the morning on the radio, and we get oversaturation of that story, and then boom, no coverage.
Right.
So that same psychology is being reinforced by the mainstream, and I believe it's methodical. I believe that's part of the brainwashing paradigm is binge and purge, baby.
And then when you say this is the police state, people say, oh, we don't live in a police state.
Right.
It's because they've forgotten the previous police state activity.
They forgot the crisis that happened before the crisis that happened before the crisis
Laws that were passed, or the laws that were under the table passed.
Sure.
Or all the other things that are pushed down.
Yeah.
You know, the bills that are avoided by the executive orders.
It's that Hegelian dialectic hammering away at all our gray matter like a metronome of tyranny, and it's very methodical. I mean, it can't be by accident that you get such a refined system of oversaturation of a thought form or a meme, and then nothing. The binge and purge thing is there, and it's frightening. I mean, the scene in the Matrix when Morpheus stared in awe at the remains of the dead being liquefied and fed back to the living. I mean, those same kind of things are going on in our consciousness. That same kind of psychology that was metaphorically conveyed in that fiction work is being done on the streets right now. It's being done. You're hearing Clyde's voice now. You're hearing my voice. And Clyde was talking about the purge, Catching Fire and the Hunger Games stuff. The psychology of that stuff is just amazing. I mean, it's all about the media and people's perception and guiding and controlling revolutions
through the media.
Through the media in that storyline, and it's happening. That movie aired this week, and Ferguson is happening this week.
Media was perpetrating this. They were pushing it beforehand.
Sure.
And it's so funny because I'm sitting there watching Katniss being told by Plutarch, you're not believable enough. You're not convincing us.
Right. We need to put you out there in a real war so that you can be convincing, so that your tears can be juiced by the machine to be manipulated. Yes.
Exactly.
So creepy.
I know.
Yeah. And I'm not saying...
Put her in the middle of the war, have her see all the dead bodies, and sure she'll react that way.
Sure, sure. And I want to be very clear with your audience. I'm not saying there's some grand conspiracy. What I'm saying is people with a similar ideology will... On an instinctual way, they will band together to protect oneself. So they don't have to form a great cabal. Mm-hmm. The rich want to stay rich, and they want to keep the poor poor. And so they'll naturally conspire to one another the same way that your eye will start to close if a sharp branch starts going towards it. So they just start, you know, forming alliances, and they do it instinctually because they're addicted to control.
Sure.
And honestly, the psychology of a slave is they're addicted to being a slave. And you talked about revolution earlier, Clyde. I think I'm participating in a revolution, you know, and allow me to explain what I mean by that is I believe that the proletariat, for lack of a better word, the common man and woman outnumber the elite millions and millions to one, scores of millions. So if we all resist what we perceive as a tyranny just a little bit, we can overwhelm them and cause an effect of a positive change. So all you have to do is resist just a tiny bit. That's what I do with my film, The Police Portland Project, is I, you know, encourage people to film the police to keep them accountable. It's my little contribution. Now, if I could figure out how to inspire millions of other people to just resist just a tiny little bit, we'd get some positive change in society.
Well, it makes me wonder, too. I mean, if you look at, like, we're talking about the meme of the Hunger Games and this whole Mockingjay thing. You saw how President Snow handled everything after Katniss did what she did, and it was really odd the way he kind of respected a little bit of what was going on.
Sure.
And that's what gave me the creeps. It's like, would we do something so great that the president would have to stop and say, okay,
right,
I'm a little bit intimidated by this. I think I'll back off a bit.
Right.
And that's what I'm curious is what would be the intimidation factor? Not threatening the president directly.
Sure.
But at least giving him something to pause and say, when will the people rise up and do what they're supposed to do?
Sure.
Not a revolution with arms and guns and bullets.
Right.
But a revolution where people are having revelations about what can be done using the Constitution, the law, and the grand jury.
Sure.
They use a grand jury when they need to indict those that they want to pick out. Why can't we organize a grand jury and indict one of them and send
a people's grand jury? Yes. Yeah, absolutely.
Why can't we do that?
We can.
Don't think about it. All we think we can do is just protest.
Right. It's that paradigm that was solidified in our popular consciousness since the 1960s, and people can't seem to break out of it.
Yeah.
People need to actually, if you want to cause a positive change in the world, and I don't care if you're white, right wing, left wing, or chicken wing, it doesn't matter your political ideology. It matters that you change a life pattern. Here's an idea for your listeners, Clyde. If you don't like something a corporation's doing, how about not buying their stuff? You know, make a small bullet point list of corporations you don't like. Don't buy their stuff. That's way better than voting. I guarantee you that corporation, if enough people stop buying their products, they will modify what they're selling to keep up with the market because they're in vicious competition with each other.
That's right.
They'd have no choice. We'd have them all by the balls.
Pretty
people
much.
Don't make little tiny life changes. And I find that just appalling that people can't wake up enough just to change their life just a little bit.
I think they can. Bit.